I swear, a movie has not made me laugh this hard in a while. Once upon a time, on a movie streaming site called Netflix, an adaptation of an immensely popular Japanese franchise spanning over anime, manga, and wouldn't you know it, live-action movies was released. While most people thought it would be absolute garbage, I was one of the few who kept their minds open, because who knows, right? Maybe this could be the movie to clear the name for live-action anime adaptations. Well, guess what? It wasn't. Hello everyone, this is the RPG Monger, and while I know for a fact there will be countless others making videos on this exact topic today, after seeing this travesty, I could not resist immediately writing this video. But for review's sake, at least for the beginning portion of this video, I'll try to maintain as unbiased as I possibly can. I owe you all that much. Now wouldn't you think that, oh, since I've already seen Death Note, I don't need to hear the synopsis of the movie? Well, my friend, that is where you're terribly mistaken. We start out with Light Turner, who is everyone's favorite underdog, who is getting the short end of the stick by everyone in his life. What a tragic hero indeed. Well, wouldn't you know it, out of the sky, a mysterious notebook falls conveniently synced up with a lightning strike. Fun fact, this is one of the few actual parallels between the source material and this movie. So once he's in detention and his life seems like it's never gonna get better, the lights go out mysteriously and terrible acting ensues once Light discovers the death god himself, Ryuk. Oh, and that's the other thing. Aside from the Death Note, Ryuk sometimes, and L sometimes, those are just about all the parallels between the Netflix movie and the original. So from here on out, instead of taking a potato chip and eating it, Light decides to eat something else while putting names into the Death Note. But jokes aside, you can probably guess what Light does once he has the Death Note and all. So I'm just gonna move directly to discussing the plot itself because, wow. Just wow. Light Turner, God, I'm never gonna get used to that, is an absolute shadow of his original character. First off, Light's character has always been that of absolute determination, a willingness to do whatever, whenever, to bring him one step closer to his final goal. He was a character who, while did indeed have a solid sense of justice and determination from right and wrong, was corrupted by the Death Note, and in turn becoming more of a victim than anything. Not to mention, he's an absolute genius and can be manipulative in just about every sense of the word. Overall, a pretty great character in my opinion, and part of the reason the franchise has so much success. But how about this soggy pancake? Well, what about the absolute determination? You know, one of Light's original defining traits? Poof. Just like that, it's nowhere to be seen, with him refusing to kill those in his way. Funnily enough, that exact trait ended up being given to another main character. But we'll talk about her soon, don't worry. Well, how about the whole deal with the Death Note corrupting Light? Even with their completely different story, that could be fit in, right? And it actually was, but not in the way you would imagine. Unlike the original story where Light's personality is altered forever, Netflix Light's personality stays dumb and the only things that get corrupted are the people around him instead of himself, ironically enough. What of those other characters though? Compared to Light, do they add to the movie at all? Short answer, not at all. Long answer, well, let's just start with Mia. Okay, so I'm not exactly sure about this, but I think Mia is supposed to be Misa from the original. I could be wrong on that, but if I'm not, then what world are we living in? Remember how in the original story, Light would do everything in his power to keep others from finding out about his true nature? Well, in this movie, he just straight up reveals everything to the one girl he wants to, you know, eat potato chips with. In the source material, Misa was a blind follower of Light, completely enamored with him and his sense of justice. While that admiration is maintained in this movie, at least for the first half, she actually ends up being more Light than Light himself. She even suggests killing those in his way multiple times. And along with doing it behind his back anyways, in the end of the movie, she ends up actually betraying Light, completely contradicting her original main character trait of being absolutely devoted to him. I swear, I do not know how they managed to end up swapping such important traits like these. Oh, and don't forget, she also serves as fuel for the terrible mopey teen romance that happens within the first 20 minutes of the actual movie. I mean, I have have to hand it to them. That's gotta be record time for absolutely ruining good characters. I don't know if it's a matter of the fake romance from the original being misconstrued or something, but I know one thing. It truly did set a mediocre tone for the things to come. Light, destroyed. Misa, destroyed. But what about L? At the very least, the trailers showed promise for him, right? Well, oddly enough, he actually plays his role quite well, for the first half of the movie, that is. Aside from Light and Ryuk, L is undoubtedly one of the best characters from this series, with the original never being quite the same after his absence. And while L's odd behavior and quirky problem solving did make it through into this movie, it's once and after his encounter with Light that his character starts dipping largely towards the pit. One of L's more defining features was the fact that even in the face of despair, he would always use his superior wit to triumph. It was his detective dynamic that made the series really what it was. However, what would happen if you stripped that dynamic away and replaced it with a character who did not think things through and ends up losing not because of an unavoidable trap, but because he acted on impulse? Well, my friends, that's exactly what happens in this travesty, with there being an actual chase scene between Light and L. A chase scene that ends with L losing by getting hit by some random alley man. You heard me right, just some random guy who then says, "Lord Kira," and that's it. Up to this point of the movie, I was howling with laughter at how bad everything was. But it was here that I honestly got quite a bit peeved at just how horribly all these characters were written. Oh, and Ryuk was pretty decent throughout the movie. That is, until he actually began to conspire against Light and even threatened to kill him. But you know, all's fair in love and Netflix. That's enough of me harping on the characters though. Moving on from all of that, now let's take a look at the overall movie from a glance. The acting. Honestly, this may be the only thing that kept this movie somewhat entertaining part of the time. And it's not because the acting is stellar, but because it sometimes becomes so lackluster that I burst out laughing. Especially the scene where Ryuk first appears, I think I even had tears in my eye. But how about the special effects? I mean, especially with Ryuk, they had to have somewhat decent effects. And thankfully, they did, with Ryuk looking pretty decent most of the time, if not a little bit like a tree sometimes, if you catch my drift. Oh, and the big Ferris wheel surprise at the end had decent effects for what it's worth. Wait, no, I almost forgot. The whole reason this passed through with the horror genre, the deaths. Now, I really hope these were not meant to be scary because they really aren't. This movie's long, drawn-out deaths honestly give it a comedic value like no other. The worst part is, when the movie actually tries to sneak in comedy here and there, it falls extremely flat. You must also remember that it's not like they didn't have an example on what to do. There have already been a multitude of live-action Death Note movies in Japan, movies that actually did quite well, with the first trumping the Da Vinci Code in the Japanese box office. To consider this movie an adaptation would be an insult because it is clearly anything but. In the end, here are some final thoughts for you all. The Netflix Death Note movie fails on nearly all avenues for me, as let's just consider the kinds of audiences it will attract. Will it appease the fans of the source material? I highly doubt it, as at least other live-action movies try their best to cram arcs into a small, compact movie. This one just abandoned everything. How about your average adult who uses Netflix casually? I doubt they too will find much enjoyment out of this movie, as if it began to bore me, then it would definitely bore somebody who had never seen the source material. Basically, Netflix's Death Note is the best comedy movie of the year, undoubtedly. 10 out of 10, gold star, 5 stars. Oh, and a quick update for you all. As you may have noticed, I couldn't get a video out last Sunday, and I'm terribly sorry for that. But I also realized something. I never really have told you all my Twitter very much, as I never thought I had to. But now, I suggest you all go check it out, as more often than not, I post most big channel updates there. And also a few memes, but you know, that's just a bonus, really. So do give it a look. If you enjoyed this video and want to see more like it, do subscribe, and today's cool thing of the day is the original Death Note anime. In times like these with horrible adaptations, we must never forget the original that started it all. And while it may not be all that perfect, it's undoubtedly better than this crap. So that being said, I'm the RPG Monger, and don't forget that each and every one of you are fantastic.